Good morning, everybody. Hope you are all doing good. Today, I am going to share with you some understanding about evolution of yoga. Yoga is a very common term these days. It is becoming very famous. There are many short-term crash courses to make you a yoga teacher. Everybody is practicing yoga, and the government is promoting International Day of Yoga, and the whole world is celebrating the same because UNO told June 21st is International Day of Yoga. But where did this yoga come from? There are people who are telling Shiva is the first yogi. There are people who are telling, no, there are some other gurus who are the first yogi and they gave yoga. There are so many concepts. There are so many things. We are not going to see those. We are not actually seeing about who created yoga. What we are going to see is how yoga came into existence. This is what we are going to see. Okay. This is just a brainstorming session kind of thing. It is just some sharing of some questions. We are going to have some discussion on some doubts because this is a thought process which I had. So it is not like conclusion. It's thought process. I'm sharing my thought process. You can also analyze it. This was already a presentation which I made in 2019. Again, I'm presenting here because, it's a concept which I think you all should also know. Okay. Just one small question. You know, we all know about doctors. Doctors mean they'll be wearing a white coat. They'll be having a stethoscope. They'll be sitting on a chair. Or they'll be sitting near a bed with a patient. This is a normal movie scene what we see, and we know doctors look like that. But all the doctors in the world, I'm talking about the modern medical doctors, the allopathy doctors. For all the medical doctors, they graduate from a medical college. For all the medical colleges, there is a board which allows them to teach medicine. There is a hospital along with the college where the patients come and they go and learn from them, treat them, analyze them. And they all have teachers. And all teachers are doctors. So you cannot be a teacher in a medical college teaching medicine without being a doctor. Maybe you can teach basics of medical science like anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, microbiology. To teach this, you may not need to be a doctor. But some colleges prefer even those teachers to be doctors. Like they should be MBBS and then they should have some post-graduation in those basic sciences. Whoever was it, let us go to the first medical college. See, now if you want to start a medical college, you replicate a model which is already there. When you keep going like that, for the first college in the world, who was the teacher? Was he a doctor? Who taught him? If you are the first teacher for the first medical college, who taught you? How did you learn without having a teacher? Because you are the first teacher and this is the first medical college. So how did you become a teacher without learning from where you think people should learn from? It's a very interesting question. But do you have any answer? let us see, did the teacher who taught us learn from a teacher, and who taught the first teacher? Now I'll tell you another way. Alphabets. We know there are alphabets in all the languages. Let us take English. We have alphabets in English. Who invented alphabets? If somebody invented alphabets, they were not taught the alphabets because they are the inventor. Then, how did they learn the alphabets, or how did they create the alphabets? Finally, we are a bunch of people going to school to learn something which was created by somebody who did not learn what they created. That is the conclusion finally, right? And if we call ourselves literates, we are literates because we learned what an illiterate invented. Because if alphabets or the language was created by somebody, they were not taught that. Unless you are taught, unless you know how to read and write, you are not a literate. So if somebody is developing it, he was previously illiterate, and once he developed, he became literate. And it teaches you that, and you also become literate. So technically, the invention has to start from somebody who is not that somebody who he wants others to be after learning whatever he teaches. You got it clear? Now you may ask, what is the relation with this? Yeah, there is a relation. So keep this in mind when you learn anything. Okay? In that way, now we have yoga. Tell me, who was the first yogi? I'm not asking about the name. It is not the name I'm talking about. But who is he? How can he be the first yogi? If he is a yogi, where did he learn yoga from? Who taught him to be yogi? So in yoga, there are a lot of steps. We say, do not follow yoga by reading a book. Always have a teacher. So how did this first yogi become a yogi without having a teacher? How did he understand all the steps and types of yoga? And if he is the first yogi, he is going to teach everybody what is yoga. Who recognized him as a yogi? See, there are no yogis in the world. Now he claims he's a yogi. Now how do people understand what is a yogi? And nobody knows what is yoga because he's the first yogi. Now nobody knows what is yoga. Now why will people listen to him? And he tells he's a guru. Now who is authorizing him as a guru? See, first you should know about basically how a human being is having some differences from other animals. Okay, for these all questions, we cannot have answers. Because if you say Lord Shiva is the first yogi, then the question comes, how did Shiva get all the knowledge? Who taught him? How can somebody not teach him and he knows something? Or if somebody is teaching him, how can Shiva be the first yogi? Why not the person who taught Shiva is the first yogi? So if you tell there is a person before Shiva, then that person, how he became the first yogi? So this is a never-ending question. It keeps going till you understand that it is always a person who creates something, or it is a collection of many people's inputs which creates a system so complex like yoga. Is yoga really complex? No, it is not really complex. But for the way we live, the way how yoga speaks about, or the concepts of yoga, or the simplicity of yoga is so simple that we fail to recognize it as a simplicity, and we are attracted towards it only when we know the complexity of the simplicity. And even till then, till the end, we don't try to actually understand the simplicity, because complexly approaching a simple stuff cannot make it simpler. It only makes it complicated. Simple things should be seen simply, not with your eyes of intellect or questions. Yoga is a type of concept which you know how it is there, how it works, and just follow it. Or don't even know how it works, just follow it. The results will be guaranteed. But when you start analyzing yoga, it will not work well. See, we cannot even find an answer for who is the first yogi. How can you find an answer about all the explanations, whatever is told by that yogi about something which is too vast? See, vast does not mean complex. It is so vast, but it is simple. But we fail to understand because our intellect is very small. Okay. Now, we should know something about this senses. Now, why I'm talking about this is, there is a reference in a textbook in Tamil called Tholkapiyam. Okay, somebody is trying to answer here. Shashi says, someone tried some experiments, got some good results. People called it as yoga, medicine, called the process as yoga or medical science. Yes, today I will try some process and I will show some result. How many of you, of the people you think will be ready to follow that? No, it is not talking about the creating momentum and making it agree and all those things. See, all the scientists who analyze yoga now, who do research about yoga now, are only verifying yoga. They have never created anything new. If you think you understood the concept of yoga, why can't you create some new yoga poses or new yoga concepts? No, we are only analyzing and understanding and decoding what is told with whatever confidence and the knowledge you have as a scientist. You cannot create a new practice, because a scientist will see the practice in a very grosser way. The subtler way can only be experienced. It cannot be analyzed. To analyze a subtler part of something like as vast as yoga, you have to be even more subtler to even explain it. But the scientists are only interested in the more obvious thing. Okay. So, but the purpose of yoga, an upliftment of a person's life. In this regard, there is a reference in a book called Tholkapiyam. Tholkapiyam is the first book available in Tamil. See, I am telling you, it is the first book available in Tamil. So it is not the first written book. Because if it was the first written book, how did he learn or something about something what he wrote? Where is the book what he read? So who taught him? Tholkapiyam is written by a saint called Tholkapiyar. He wrote this when he was a student under a guru. Under a guru called, if I am not wrong, the guru's name is Agathiyar. And he gives a freedom. You all can create a text of your own. Then Tholkapiyar writes a text. It's a grammar text. Other all text, whatever was there before this, we do not have it now because it all were swallowed by the seas. this book is the first book, and it is believed to be 3000 or more years old. So before 3000 years approximately, what is being told here is the evolution of species based on the senses. Now, touch sense is the first sense. So, whichever organisms in the world has only the sense of touch, they have one sense, because they do not have the second sense or other senses. Then the second sense came, that is the tongue, the sense of taste. And then third one is the nose, or the sense of smell. Eye is the fourth sense. Now this all looks like an organ, not actually a sense. Then why do we call it sense? Because eye is the fourth sense organ which developed. So for organisms which are having four senses, you can see the other senses are already there. Ear is the fifth sense and mind is the sixth sense. Okay. So we generally speak about, do you have sense? But nobody asked them back, which sense are you talking about? Because yes, even if somebody's out of mind, they have the remaining other senses, because we are human beings. Mind is the one we achieved as a human being, not the other five. The other five are there for most animals. So this mind is the one which only human beings have, not other animals. Does this mind make us special from the other animals? We have to see. Now, this is a small explanation. See, you see a small deer on the screen. Now the animals, why I put a deer is because it is having five senses. I have not put an organism which has four senses. For example, birds do not have ears. Can't they hear? They can hear, but they don't have ears. Probably this is the reason this text speaks about the organs and not about the function. See, he speaks here, ear is the fifth sense, not the hearing. A cow has a big ear and it hears. A crow does not have any ear, but it hears. Now, is a bird having five senses or four senses? The organ is described as the sense, which should mean touch. Is touch an organ? No. Touch is told here as the function of something. Now the mind, whether mind is an organ or something is functioning as a mind, what is the actual mind? You see, there is an animal here, and animals are generally five sensed. Now, our modern theory says, from a monkey, human being came. It may be true, may not be true. But no text in my knowledge, traditional text, claims this. It's only modern science which claims this. So partially we may believe or partially we may ignore. But it is sure from a animal stage, the next stage is human stage. But did the animal become human? Not sure. Okay. Now, the animals do not have mind, and people, human beings, they have mind. even though a person may be handicapped, he has mind. That sense can be reduced, which we call becomes a reason for somebody to be called as handicapped. But mind is there. Even if mind is not proper, he still has mind which is not functioning properly. So human beings mean they will have mind. They also will have other senses. Now, in a world of people who have mind, you call somebody as a yogi because they do not have mind. In a way, they should be called as beyond-minded. See, this is three stages. Animals are below-minded. They do not have mind. Human beings are minded. They have mind. Yogis are beyond-minded. They cross over the mind. They are not into the mind. They are inside the mind. They actually cross the mind. To recognize even people that they are beyond mind, we require some kind of better sense, a better mind, because not everybody is able to believe or understand a yogi. Some people look at them and tell they are fake. They don't agree there is a concept like this. How can you overcome mind? Mind is very natural. It should be there. How can you grow beyond it? They have all these kind of questions. And when you talk about purpose of life, when you talk Eastern philosophy or Western philosophy, the philosophies of the countries like India and Japan, China, philosophers of these kind of lands, and also the philosophers of the Western countries, they all understand the purpose of life is liberation. There are many names for it, but liberation is the purpose of life. Once you finish living, you should be liberated. Or when during your life, you should have liberation. And there are so many liberation camps going on in many Western countries. They try so many things. They call this as liberating. When you do this, it's very liberating. So there are so many practices they're doing. There's also a park called Nude Park. People go into the park, pay money, and they are naked. And why do they do this? They feel liberated by doing this. There are so many things people do. But whatever it is, for a person to be normal and to become a person who is liberated, there are so many methods which the world follows. Some people say religion. Some people say no religion, it's only spirituality. Some people say my religion is having a lot of spirituality. Some people say my spirituality doesn't or not have any religion. Some people say religion, spirituality, both are not required. There is something else I am doing which can also do the same thing. There are so many inventions which can keep happening. But among all those things, yoga is one method which can turn a person normal to special. Okay. You did something, whatever process you can call, but you attained the stage of becoming a yogi. Now you are a yogi. Okay, now next what? What are you going to do after that? You became a yogi. Next what? Is there anything to do again? So are you going to teach what you did to others? Or are you going to experiment with what you became? Is it true? Because you are first time becoming yogi. What are you going to do next? So what is the purpose to achieve after becoming yogi? So if you do not know what to do after becoming yogi, if you also will be existing like other people after becoming a yogi, then why to become a yogi? What is the point? See, it's a very genuine doubt. It's a very genuine doubt. It's not a question I'm asking you. It's a doubt which I'm sharing with you. If you are a normal human being and you try hard doing something, either yoga or something, you try hard and become a yogi and you do not know what to do next, what is the purpose? if you know what a yogi should do after becoming a yogi, why can't do that now itself? Or is it possible only for a yogi to do what they should do after becoming yogi? And is it like only yoga can make you yogi? Or what else can make you yogi? And these are so many knowledge bases, so many contributions from our country to the world, like yoga, during times of yoga, or people who were good in yoga. Right? There are so many things like this. But these are just few things what I have written here, because we have to write something to give you an idea about what we're talking. See, all these things are from India, because we are believed to be one of the oldest civilization. Because whichever civilization you go and tell it is the oldest in the world, it somehow relates to, again, our country and our world, our practices. It again relates here. The stories what we have in our country are available in other lands also, with a reference or a significant, you know, interlink. And because it is from this land, so many things emerged. There were so many philosophers and kings who were interested in this land. So we should have been the source. And most of the knowledge is whatever now the West claims it has achieved. Those all references or some concepts were taken from here. That's what people believe. At least people who think our land was the source. At least they believe that there are so many evidences that everything started from our land. I'm not speaking about the present geographical India, but the land which is related to this India. The concept of country is a concept made by somebody. So before the concept of the country came, there were some set of mindset roaming around this part of the land. It is a contribution of them. These all sciences, or whatever you call, those days it could have been considered art, or those days it could have been considered, you know, time pass. They create something for time pass. We do not know how it was, but these all things came from inside. See, if you say somebody taught them this, the first person taught, the first person who created this is a person whom we are speaking about. For that person, this should have come from somewhere, come from inside. Because we think or teach about the world inside us, not external to us. Basically, yoga is about traveling inside, not outside. So, how can these all things come inside of a person? It is possible that it can come from a person without any input given outside. Is only possible because of something what that man was doing and others are not doing. Right? If somebody in your vicinity gets a gold medal in examination, they were doing something better than the others. So to create such something as complex as these things, see, now these all things are different professional courses. To become a Siddha doctor, you have to go to a college where they teach Siddha, and you have to be eligible for that by studying 12th standard, PUC. You have to get certain marks. Then you become eligible, and you're eligible only if you have science group. Then you go to the college, you learn for 5.5 years, and then you come back, and still they call you practice. You have to practice, keep practicing, and only then you become an expert. Even when you become an expert, there are so many questions unanswered, because we don't have medicines or cure for every disease what we know, right? So all the problems what we have are not solved by all these sciences which were considered super, right? But even then, these things are something great, phenomenal. and the people who made it were different. It is only because of such contributions somebody is considered better than the others. You do something which nobody can do, then people accept you as you are better. So this is how somebody should have accepted somebody as a yogi, somebody as a guru, because they have solutions for problems which others could not solve. They have explanations for some concepts which others could not perceive without an explanation. The more difficult to perceive concept, the more better philosopher you become. But somebody should be able to recognize that is a better understood philosophy. Only majority won't understand what you say, but a minority will understand. If nobody understands what you say, then they may not call you a yogi. So, some are in the process of understanding it a little bit. Some are in the process of explaining it to in a larger extent or deeper extent. The remaining crowd which follows you both are the people who don't understand much of it, or they only believe that the person who is expert taught to a person who understood it, but we don't understand it. They either accept it, and they are now followers of the words of the people whoever talks about it. So once the crowd confirms or approves of your higher intellect or higher knowledge or higher wisdom, both are different, they follow whatever you say. That is how traditions are formed. The experts of some subject is considered wise and knowledgeable, and whatever they say is followed by people whoever do not understand what they say, or who understand that they say something which is not very easy for these people to digest. Why I'm talking about this more is there are many levels of yogi. Today I may be dumb, but I am still in the process of becoming that special person because I am born as a human being. If one human being can become a yogi, everybody else can become a yogi. That's what yoga also says. Yoga is not pertained to anybody of any identification. Anybody who takes a path can reach destination. You take a bus from Chennai to Bombay. If you go in the right bus which goes to Bombay from Chennai, are you not going to reach the destination? Should you keep verifying whether the bus is going in the right direction? That bus is meant to go to a destination, and in that bus will carry you to that destination which it promises. You need not keep verifying. But you sit in a wrong bus, but you want to go to another destination. How much ever you verify the route, the end will be different. Now, if you follow the correct path, you will end up in the correct destination. You cannot go wrong. So everybody who are born as a human being is given an extra sense of mind to achieve what is required. See, animals cannot achieve what they require in the way human beings achieve. That reason should be mind, because it is the mind which makes you think in a way different from animals. How do we say this? We cannot understand what animals think. We cannot know whether animals have mind or not. But the result of what was there is which shows that human beings have something extra. And when they analyze and understand, then they say it is mind. Animals may not know that they are seeing with eyes. They are hearing with ears. A crow will never think why dogs have ears and they can hear, and why I am not having an ear, but still I could hear. A crow is never going to think, or it thinks beyond human beings, we do not know. But the output of what an animal does, the ultimate result of an animal's life and a human being's life, make us believe that we are better. Okay, so what is that a person does which others don't do, which gives them this kind of knowledge or wisdom, or they become resourceful about these things? So what is that they do? Now that is what is important than actually what we're you know trying to follow. For example, you try to follow yoga, but I think these questions should be a basic question asked, because you do not know what a yogi is supposed to do. Then why are you taking a path which will make you a yogi? If you follow yoga, you are going to become a yogi, irrespective of your like or dislike, because the pathway is leading somewhere. In that way, if you do not have these questions, what are you trying to do with it? So what was that which the people were doing? There could be many answers, but this is my answer. This is my thought. Because all those people in those days lived at peace with nature. They followed nature. See, what is available in this world? Remove all the things man-made. Then what is remaining? Those all things, what is remaining, a man cannot make. To make a drop of water, you have to spend a lot of money. See, I am not saying you cannot make water. You can make water. A human being can create a drop of water. How? We know water is H2O, hydrogen and oxygen. So why can't you create water? If hydrogen and oxygen can combine and create water, why the air, the oxygen, hydrogen in the air is not becoming water? Because hydrogen and oxygen is part of the water, but hydrogen and oxygen put together doesn't become water. It requires some reaction which stimulates this production. So I asked my teacher, if hydrogen and oxygen is water, why this air is not becoming water and continuously pouring down? Then he said, it can happen when you take the correct proportion, put in a special container and initiate the transformation with the spark. So there is a chemical reaction stimulated with the event. Now, if this is the way to create water, did the nature create a spark to create water? I don't think so. Because for the amount of water what we have in this earth, do you think one spark can create it? Or if one spark can create it, where was all the hydrogen oxygen and in which chamber was it kept and the spark was created? Or did he have crores of chambers like that and created a spark in every chamber? See, this is all not very possible to think. But these are the baby questions, what I'm having. Because I think these questions are a requirement to understand something so complex. Because if you can't answer something with a simple question, how can you understand a complex thing? So how did the water in this whole earth come into existence? So it is not by the way we know. We know with chemistry that you take this much of hydrogen, this much of oxygen and put together and create a spark, it can become water. But this is not how nature made water. So nature was available and we came. Whether we came from a microorganism, we grew to every level, we evolved and we attained those senses and then we became humans, or those organisms are just kept there and we also were kept there, but we are believing that we evolved. We do not know any of these things, but all the possibilities are possible, because that's why it's called a possibility. But those things were existing and human beings are not changing nature. See, the nature is existing. They live with it and they lived well with it. Probably that is what could have given the growth. If in case we evolved from microorganisms are true, then from every level we are gaining something. For example, the sense of touch is there for all the plants. Plants cannot taste. Plants cannot smell. Plants cannot hear. No, recent studies says they all can hear, they can feel, yes. But with your sense, can you understand whether a plant can hear or not? The experiments with which they understood that plants can feel and the plants can hear, the plants can smell, is all actually a complex research, which without those technology, we cannot find out. So the plant's ability to hear or smell are all not obvious, but a plant's ability to feel the touch is very obvious. Because as a plant with, if you touch it, it shrinks. There are plants, if you touch, it'll catch your hands, it'll catch your fingers. You know the plants which eat the insects? So on touch, they react. But on showing a flavor, odor, the plants don't show us a reaction. The plant may undergo a change, but it does not show us. So with our normal senses, we can't perceive. The yogis who lived in the olden days, or special people whom we can call by a term yogi, they were living with nature with their senses probably completely active. We have six senses, but are we using the six senses? Are we using our ears perfectly for whatever is meant to be? Yeah, we are hearing whatever is there around us, but is that the purpose or is there anything else beyond which you do not know? Then how are yogis listening to something which nobody else hears? Even a psychological patient can hear the same thing, but yogis are different. So an activity of hearing something which is not audible to everybody else is in one extreme considered a disease. In another extreme, it is called as something special. It's a boon, something a magic. But we are able to understand or accept that these special people were living with other people, but they lived more in tune with laws of nature. So they had some evolution. Because if animals are evolving, they are doing only one thing. They are living as per the laws of nature. They cannot change the laws of nature. They cannot change their food if they want. Always they eat the same food. A cow eats grass. All its relatives eat grass. All the varieties of the cows eat grass. All the varieties of cows in any part of the world eats grass. And for generations, they never felt bored. Daily morning, they start grazing a grassland. Evening, they come back and rest. Again, morning, they start doing the same thing. They are never bored for years together. But we have the same food for 3 days straight. We start asking, why same food? Why there is no different food? Why can't we have something interesting? But the interesting food what we have is also boring after a few days. But how come animals are eating the same food every day? So animals which live are all following the laws of nature. They don't change it. Probably this is what led to the evolution of human beings also. All beings lived with nature as per the law of nature. And that is the result. If the path is followed properly, destination has to be arrived. And probably that is nature's plan A. And by following this, we evolved. What is plan A? Give mind to a stage of evolution called humans. Now, what is the result of mind? With mind, we can change. What we can change? Now, human beings have got so much power that they can decide whether to keep this earth intact or destroy it. there are so many powers with human beings about destruction than creation. I'm not saying construction, it's a creation. Because we can construct, we can't create. Both are different. You can construct a machine. You cannot create life into the machine. Because construction is easy. It is putting together whatever things we think will work. But creation is not that. Human beings are powerful with destruction, not creation. Maybe construction. But all the construction, whatever it does, is in a way also destructive. Now, there are two things which can happen. If you go along in the nature's plan, like see from sense 1 to sense 6, we have come. The same path if we take, we may evolve from a human being to a yogi, and something may be there which is visible only when you become a yogi. Or plan B, we can change this evolution. See, now we are not actually evolving. Are we better than our grandfathers? May not be. So are we evolving? No. So what is that we should do now? What is it we should understand now? See, in my thought process, in my understanding of these many years of experience, of being with people who talk about nature from my childhood, and being with people who talk about yoga and special powers and special purposes of being a yogi or learning yoga or something. From childhood, I'm seeing a lot of these people in my life. And with this, what I think is plan A, the normal evolutionary process, is to attain the seventh sense. Or at least you attain the state of a yogi. You become a resource person. You become a person who is able to see which others are not able to see. This evolution, in other words, become a yogi yourself by doing what the first yogi was doing. It should make sense. See, a person can teach us, but we also have the ability to become that person who is the first teacher. So we can become creators. We can become creators if we also do what those people were doing in those days. And what it could be, in present terms, this is what it is called. If they lived with nature, they lived a life, and they attained some knowledge. They attained some level of knowledge, which they gave to the whole world. Now that knowledge we take as yoga, and we follow it. Some are following it to just to be healthy. Some are following it just to earn. Some are following it just to get rid of their diseases. Some are following it to become a yogi. There are ashrams where people do yoga to become a yogi. There are similar ashrams which teach yoga to heal people. So what is the purpose of yoga? The purpose of yoga is always the ultimate, to make you a yogi. And then, we do not know, but to make you a yogi. You can learn those yoga concepts, practices, and become a yogi, or also do what was done by those people and become a yogi. Both are possible. We choose to take their path, which is simple, that is learn from somebody. So, in the present day terminology, when you live with nature, here specifically I'm talking about nature cure, because health is a required tool to attain the journey, whatever we have. The animals which are not very healthy cannot evolve. If a diseased animal is evolving, how it is called evolving? Because the next product is better than the previous product. So only an animal with the supreme health can become better, not the one which is having a disease. The abilities of that animal's physique should be at the best and the maximum for the animal to become better. So two deers which have a good sense of smell and hearing will produce a baby which is better in that sense. Now this is what we understand. Good qualities keep uniting, then it becomes a better quality. If we mix two bad qualities, that offspring is not good. It may not even live longer. So the nature selects things which are better and put into combination with something else better to create something even more better. In present day life, when people talk about yoga, they do not talk about living with nature. You go to any yoga center, they tell you to be with nature, but they never give a food which is of nature. They recommend you to eat fruits, but they give cooked food. Reasons, I'm not interested. They may say any reason, but I think it's a compromise. It is not actual reason. And people talk about nature, or talk about nature cure, to be specific. Because in these days, we use yoga for health, nature cure for health. We use nature for attaining health, not to achieve what that health should achieve. If you do not have a motive to attain something with health, and health becomes destination, you may not attain that because your whole life you're only trying to attain health, not the gift of that health. This is what is lacking in our understanding when we try to follow either yoga or nature cure. And you see in this box, this nature cure has a representation with a pink box, and there is a small gap here for green. It is intentional. Similarly, is the small pink opening in the end of yoga. Because when you start your life itself, you can only live more with nature. You cannot live more with yoga. Because yoga itself is not a living. You live in a yogic way. But you cannot live yoga unless you live naturally. Having everything artificial around you and following a posture in yoga is not yoga. Because yoga is not about the poses. Yoga is not about the pranayamas. It is not about the meditation. It is through all these things what you become. That is yoga. What is the definition of yoga? It is a union of what? You are a part of this bigger cosmos. Your small cosmos is going to unite with the bigger cosmos. You think a pranayama can do that? Do you think a specific posture can do that? It is not the posture or the pranayama. It is the output of the ultimate knowledge of this yoga that will give you something which can unite you with that bigger cosmos. When we talk about such an ultimate thing, it is not about the practice. These practices are preparation for something. By doing these practices of asanas or pranayamas, you are preparing your body to achieve or undergo something else. You cannot achieve that without understanding nature or living with nature. Even most ashrams nowadays are sophisticated. I'm not saying that is wrong, but can they give you the best result of living with nature? And there are many people who talk about nature, but do not understand, by living with nature, you actually evolve into something else, and that one method is yoga. Or they don't talk about any method which does that. So following nature without understanding a concept or a methodology like yoga, or talking about yoga without understanding the concept of living with nature as per the laws of nature, is not going to be very fruitful evolution. Nowadays, nature is only in words. Greenwood's apartments is not inside Greenwood's. River view apartments is not viewing a river, or it's only viewing a river which does not have water. we have all the names which are green, which are woods, which are forest. But why we name them? Because we are not in that place. If you are living inside a forest, will you name your home as deep woods? No, you may not name like that. We are trying to keep a name which we do not have, because it is a attainment of something without attaining that. We're compromising. Do not compromise yourself in the name of learning yoga by not living with nature. Do not live with nature by not understanding that such processes are the ones which carry you to an evolution, or live with nature so perfectly and do what the olden days people were doing to become a product of that evolution, or create a solution for the current day problem. Do either of this. If a person follows nature cure without following yoga, he cannot maintain health for a longer duration. If a person follows yoga, whatever has been taught to him, without following a nature cure method of life, he cannot reach the main purpose of yoga. This is what is my understanding with the questions whatever I had. This is just a sharing of thought process, but this thought process is a strong belief inside me. All my nature cure sessions or yoga sessions will be linked, because I believe this strongly, and I do not have reason why not to believe this strongly. If you think there is some other way of thinking, think detailed, think deep. Either make a presentation or make a write-up or record an audio or record a video, whatever. Let us have a discussion. Please share it. Okay? But this is my understanding. And when you start nature cure, it has to start with yoga also, but very minimal. When you keep traveling, automatically yoga will become a part of your life. And it looks like nature cure is done very less and you're doing more yoga. But actually, it's the base. It's actually the base. So this is what I wanted to share with you all. And when you follow nature cure, you automatically start doing what is recommended in yoga. That is how nature cure would have evolved to make a yogi. These all thoughts were made more concrete in myself, because whenever I followed some simple nature cure things, it made some changes which is required in yoga, the practices of yoga. And that's when I understood probably these concepts of yoga would have come only because people followed this so precisely or so deeply. So let us also follow nature cure. And along with that, some yoga, which can make our life easier and sustain health for a longer duration. And if you're already into some yoga, understand natural life to an extent that it can make your ultimate goal to be achieved very easily. Okay, so this is my small sharing of thought. Thank you so much for your patient listening, and hope you have understood whatever I wanted to say, or I have tried my best to make you understand in a simpler way, and hope that has happened. If you have any things to say or share, these are my contacts. Please share with me whatever you feel like. And even now you are free to share. Is there anything you would like to ask or say? You can even type or talk, but talking is better because it is audible to everybody. And you see, we are having only 10 people. The maximum today what we had was 11. I think you all should spread the word and bring more people. The same set of people are coming daily. try to bring more people. Okay, so if you do not have anything to share, let us close for today, and we will meet again tomorrow. Thank you so much.